Hey guys, welcome to the Lord Teach Me to Study the Bible in 28 Days by Kay Arthur. This is just getting started. I will do an introduction class, so that's going to make us a total of 5 weeks that we will actually be together. But when reviewing some things this morning, it occurred to me that there are some other things that I wanted to share with you prior to our beginning. I'm so excited. We've waited so long to do this, and I hope that you are just as excited as I am about this. While I was reviewing a couple of things today, I feared that if I added what I want to share with you today in our getting started, and so this video will be before our actual introduction to the class, I feared that if I tried to pile that all in, it would be one long video, and this will allow you also to maybe hit the pause button, stop it, make some notes, because these are some things that I wanted to share with you that I learned early on when I first started taking this. And if I'm not mistaken, to the best of my recollection, I actually took this study 3 times years and years ago. And since 2007, I've actually led this, sometimes twice a year, but I have led it pretty much consistently, not every single year. I think there's a 1 or 2, maybe 3 years total between 2007 and 2019 that I actually didn't, but then there were some years that I actually led this twice. And so for fear of me making that video too long, I wanted to do what is called getting started. And I hope that the lighting is okay on this. I keep trying to adjust it, and so I hope that it will work for us. Just a shout out to my girl Tabitha for my Living in Faith Together t-shirt for our Lift page. Way to go, girl. Love my shirt. So comfortable. And for those of you who are a part of our Lift page and our Lift study group, just see Tabitha if you're wanting a shirt, a cup, whatever it is she has out there going on that she is creating and making for our group. So again, this is just a getting started video for you, because these are some things that I didn't want to skip over. And normally when leading this study in a class, these are some notes that I would go over. Now, when I just led this in August of 2019 with the girls at work, I was not able to go over these things because we just didn't have time. Some of us only had 30 minutes for lunch. Some of us stayed an hour. And so we just had to kind of rush through it. And again, this will be my first time ever leading this study via online. I have never done that. I've always been in a classroom setting, leading people through this. And this is a study that I've never grown tired of, because people are so excited, A, to start, but B, they're excited about learning the process of studying God's Word inductively. And so we are going to try to take as much time as we need, but it's going to be a little bit different for me because, again, I'm used to sitting across from you and seeing these light bulbs go off in your head. But that's what the comment section is for, and when I post a video. So I did want to share some things with you. If you have a notebook and a pen, I would recommend that you get that in case you want to write down some notes. But to go over the items that you will need for this study, of course, is your notebook. Mine looks like this, your workbook, excuse me. Mine looks like this, but I went and had a new one spiraled at the Office Depot, and then I had this little cover on it to kind of keep it from the page tearing and all of that. I have a lot of notes in this old raggedy thing right here, and I just, I don't know if I can get it all transferred over. But so I have this one close by because this is the one that I've led out of so many times. Also, you know that you will need your Bible. You do not have to have an inductive study Bible in order to participate in this study. You use the translation of your choice. But you will need a Bible. And if you don't have a Bible, you can look for the observation worksheets in the back of your workbook, and we'll go over that during the introduction. So I don't want to spend a lot of time on there. Also, I would highly recommend that you get some colored pencils. Now, this wonderful thing right here was a gift from Brenda White. She sent this in the mail to me, and I don't know how I have lived without this all these years of teaching inductive study method. And when I study personally, I use these colored pencils. Now, don't get all nervous. We don't use all of these every day. So I just wanted to show you either kind of pencil that you have is something that I would recommend. And I would definitely recommend you starting off with using colored pencils so that you can erase them should you make a mistake and no harm is done. Now, as far as my pens that I use, all of these items are listed on our Lift page under, I believe it's called Bible Resources. And so it shows a picture of all of the things that I've mentioned here. Also, now, these pens right here, I do not use in my Bible. I do not use those to write in my Bible. I use these to journal. And I used to journal a whole lot more, but I've gotten really, really busy here lately, so I haven't had as much time to journal. But, or you can use this type of pen to write in your workbook if you want to use a pen. These pens right here are the Micron pens, and they are the 005s. Not 05, but 005s. And I use these colors, and I also have a brown one that's not shown in here. But you can start off with the 4-pack color if you want to. These are the pens that I use to write in my Bible. They don't bleed through. Now you can see somewhat of a shadow on the next page, but when you write over it on the next page, you can't see it. Also, I've found that it's really, really good for when you're making notes in your Bible that you want to write in. You can also take a pencil and color over that pen, and it preserves it, and it also helps it to stand out. So you can get these Micron pens at Michael's or Hobby Lobby, or many ordered from cbd.com and ordered the 4-pack, and I think there may even be an 8-pack. I'm not sure. So I just wanted to show you those, and I may show those again to you on our intro video that I'm going to do. So there are a couple of things that I wanted to go over with you, some things that I have received years and years ago that I've always kept, and I wanted to go over them with you because I think they're really important. And so just take you some notes, hit pause on me if you want to write some things down, but I wanted to share with you what the inductive method study consists of, what it's about. And these notes, I believe, don't quote me on this, I believe they were given to us, or they were copied from precept.org about inductive_Bible_study. I don't know if that's still available because, again, I've been doing this a long, long time. So I'm just going to share with you some notes, and if there was a way that we could get this document uploaded, and I will ask our admin, Vicki Hames, if we can do that. So that way, if you have a way to copy them, then you could do that and have them in your notebook. So, but if not, I'm just going to do the best that I can to go over some things with you about the inductive method that we're going to learn. So the inductive study method is an investigative approach to the Bible using three components. And the three components consist of observation first, interpretation, and then application. And so the observation means we're going to discover what it says. And so the very first thing that I wanted to mention about observation is that it teaches you to see exactly what the passage says. It is the basis for accurate interpretation and correct application. So observation answers the question, what does the passage say? So the first thing that they recommend that you do, and that I recommend in any Bible study that I have ever led, is when you are doing a Bible study, before you open the Bible, begin with prayer. And that is key. That is important. So if you don't learn another thing, I hope that you will learn that and actually implement that into your Bible study time, is to pray first. Because prayer, she says, is often the missing element in Bible study. And so you're about to learn the most effective method of Bible study yet that there is. But apart from the work of the Holy Spirit, that's all it will be, is a method. So that's why it is so important for you to pray first. And for years, I didn't know what a quiet time was. And I think I've shared this in other lessons that I've done with you. But I didn't know about a quiet time, a personal quiet time with the Lord. And so it's vital to pray first. And I certainly didn't know how important it was to read my Bible. So pray first, open your Bible, and then go from there. So next we want to talk about asking the five W's and the H. So you need to try to train yourself to constantly ask who, what, when, where, how, and why, because these are building blocks of precise observation. A lot of times I think in Proverbs that when I would mention something, if a sentence started with, or mid-sentence, it said, so that, well, that's our why. And so sometimes you would hear me say, you know, why, or where are we, or when did this happen? So I just wanted to remind you of that. Also, you will learn about keywords and marking keywords and phrases. So a keyword is one that is essential to the text. Keywords and phrases are repeated in order to convey the author's point of purpose for writing. So keywords can be marked as symbols. They can be marked as a way of a particular color or a combination of both. So some people find it that using the colors are not as overwhelming as symbols. So I'm going to say to you, do what feels best for you. Do what is most comfortable for you, because the symbols and the colors are not as important as the text. So if you get so caught up in that, and you will at first, you will, you'll be a little overwhelmed, but we're going to push through that, then don't get so caught up in that, okay? Just make yourself available, pray first, open that Bible, and then just watch for words that are repeated over and over and over again. And there's a reason that they are. That those are the words that we need to pay special attention to. So sometimes if you come across making lists, making lists can be one of the most enlightening things you do as your study, she said. Lists reveals truths and highlights important concepts. And then she gave 1 Peter 5, 2, and 3. For example, it contains a simple list regarding the role of the elder, shown by numbering the items in the text. And it's also helpful for you to make a list of what you learn about each keyword or person that you mark. If something is said, and then there are three or four different things about that particular thing, I just simply take one of my pens that I showed you, the Micron pens, and I'll make a one, circle it, and a two, and circle it, so that I can study that list. So, again, I'm giving you some suggestions and some ideas. If you want to implement one thing, do one thing, and be done with it, you're going to do great. Now, the next thing is, while we are observing the text, we want to watch for contrasts and comparisons, because they paint word pictures to make it easier to remember what we've learned. So For example, Peter compares the devil to a roaring lion, and then he also contrasts God's attitude toward the proud and the humble. So that, again, is in reference to 1 Peter. So also, something that most of you have learned in just the brief study of Proverbs, we went all the way through it. I didn't implement a lot of these practices because some of you were new to the inductive method, period. And so we didn't do a lot of this, but that's what we're here for, is that's to learn and to dig deeper and to grow and to learn how to observe the passage, interpret the passage, and then most importantly, apply the words that we have studied. So note expressions of time. Marking time will help you see the sequence or the timing of events and lead accurate interpretation of scriptures. So basically what I do is I take a green pen and I make a circle. And in that circle, I make a long hand and a short hand, and then I put some little tiny feet on the bottom. I'll kind of show you a picture of it if you can. You see that right there? That's how we mark a time phrase. Now, also look and watch for geographical locations. Geographical locations tell us where an event takes place. And I normally, if I come to the word Jerusalem or Greece or Nineveh or wherever the place is, a geographical location, I double underline the name of that location in green. Also, we want to mark terms of conclusion, words such as therefore, thus, and for this reason. They indicate that a conclusion or summary is being made. You can either underline them in the When I come to the word therefore, this is how I mark the word therefore, because it causes me to stop and look at what the conclusion is. So if you see it right here, you'll see that I just put three little dots on the word therefore using a red pen. Now, that's about observation. Interpretation, let's look at that. Interpretation discovers, it helps us to discover what the passage means. Now, if you can't get all of this written down, I'm just going to briefly discuss these things when we actually do the introduction to this, so don't panic. So, while observation leads to understanding of what the Word of God says, interpretation helps you understand what it means. And for those of you who have the Inductive Study Bible, all of these things are mentioned in the very front of your book as you read through that and you learn how to study. Now, I don't implement every single thing that's in the front of the Bible, and it is like the best Bible in my personal opinion, because I have a lot of Bibles, but I have used this one for years. It's my go-to. It's the one that I read every day. And so it has some of these instructions in the very beginning. So if you are a deep thinker and you want to do everything just according to how she says to do it, read those instructions carefully. I can't remember everything, so I just implement the things that I can remember. So we want to remember that context rules. The word context means that which goes with the text. Ask yourself, is my interpretation of this passage of Scripture consistent with the theme? Is it consistent with the purpose and structure of the book in which it is found? Never take a Scripture out of its context to make it say what you want it to say. Okay? That's the first thing about interpretation. The second thing is always seek the full counsel of the Word of God. When you know God's Word thoroughly, you will not accept a teaching simply because someone has used one or two isolated verses to support it. Okay? Saturate yourself in the Word of God. It is your safeguard against any wrong doctrine. It is our duty as his followers to study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So it is our responsibility as followers of Jesus to know and study so that we are not receptive of every doctrine that is taught, of every message, sermon, lesson that is given to us. And so saturate yourself in the Word of God. You're learning how to study it. And so always seek the full counsel of the Word of God. Number three, remember that Scripture will never contradict Scripture. All Scripture is inspired by God. It is God-breathed. Scripture will never contradict itself. Don't take a teaching to an extreme that God doesn't. Simply humble your heart in faith and believe what God says, even if you can't fully understand or reconcile it at the moment. If God, the author, has not emphasized it, then we shouldn't. Okay? Pray God's word back to him. I believe in the very beginning of our Proverbs study, I gave you the passage of scripture from James chapter 1, verse 5. For any man who lacks wisdom, let him come to and ask of God, who gives to all men liberally. So go read James 1, 5. If you don't understand a scripture, that's not a reason to close the book and not ever open it again, okay? Pray about it. The Holy Spirit that resides in you, once you are a believer, a follower of Jesus, you've asked him to come into your heart and your life and to be Lord of your life, and I hope that every one of you has. It is his will that he teaches us truth and all things. So pray for wisdom. Remember, pray before you start. Also, number four, don't base your convictions on an obscure passage of Scripture. And an obscure passage is one that's not easily understood. But they should never be used as a basis for establishing doctrine. Okay? Number five is to interpret Scripture literally. God spoke to us that we might know truth. So you have to look first for the clear teaching of Scripture, not a hidden meaning. It's not anything that he doesn't want us to fully understand. Now, the sixth thing about interpretation is to look for the single meaning of the passage. Try to understand what the author has in mind. Don't twist verses to support a meaning that is not clearly taught. Let the passage speak for itself. Okay, these are helps. These were meant to help you in your beginning, in your learning. And if you have these notes, and again, I will see if we can get these notes posted in a document format so that you might print them. Or if not, just take some time, put me on pause and write you down some notes so that you can just glance back. Also, again, for those of you who have the inductive study Bible, you can look at some of these things in the very front of your Bible. Now, the last thing that we want to talk about is the application. We've talked about observation, observing the passage. We've talked about interpretation of the passage. And now we want to talk about application. And there's a very short, brief paragraph that I'm just going to read directly off the page that was given to me when I first started learning to study this way. But application is discovering what it means practically. Okay, the first step in application is to find out what the Word of God says on any particular subject through accurate observation and correct interpretation of the text. Once you understand what the Word of God teaches, you are then obligated before God to accept that truth and to live by it. So I hope that this method, the explanation of the method, the explanation of the observation, interpretation, and application will help you. Look, this is all new to you. This was new to me back in the early 2000s. For a long time, I had this book. I wouldn't even pick it up. I was so intimidated by it. I was so overwhelmed by it, which is why that I took it three times, and I took it with a group of people. That's why you've heard me say, once you get this book, don't start on it without being in a group of people that will help you, will encourage you, will spur you on. And let me tell you something, again, if I've not already said it, we're not quitters. We are conquerors. And the enemy wants to come against you because he does not want you to know how to study the very words of God that was written to us and for us. So he wants to discourage you in any way that he can. But listen, we are conquerors. We are not quitters. And we're going to get through this together. And let me tell you something. If you press through this, and I believe that you will, you will be so glad you did, and there will be such a passion ignited in you that you're not going to be able to stand it without buying somebody this book and asking them to meet you for 5 weeks, one time a week, to go through this so that you can teach them what you have learned in our time together. Listen, I hope this has helped you. Again, I will be doing an introduction to the Lord Teach Me to Study the Bible in 28 Days for our kickoff, which makes it a 5-week study. And I will go over some of the things that I've mentioned here today, but I just wanted to give you an opportunity to take some notes prior to us getting started. I hope that you have a blessed day, and I will see you soon.